The most difficult challenges, obviously, are 94% free and reduced lunch and the lead contamination issue. We just can't rule it out as a possibility that's lended itself to our students having enormous difficulties to overcome. Approximately 50,000 people in the early 20s lived here, all kinds of businesses and those kinds of things. I mean, it was just a boom town. It just went up overnight. And so all the homes are built around the chat piles. As you were driving in, you could see them because people had to walk to work, of course. The chat, the mountainous ranges looking things that you saw outside, that's the refuse. That's what's left over after they took the lead and zinc out of the ground. And the lead was used primarily for the World War I and II occupations. Some for the Korean conflict and some for the Vietnam War, but it provided, you know, over 90% of the lead that was used to fight those battles. And so the chat's what's left over, and of course we view the chat piles as our friends. When they have ice and snow on them, you can sled. They look like mountains, and we had all of our ballparks are built beside them or at the base of them, all of our parks, so we grew up with them feeling like they're a part of us. I mean, we had birthday parties there, we climbed them for fun. The chat in its larger form is worth a lot of money, so what they've been doing over the course of my lifetime is hauling it out because they sell it to other states and other companies, because mixed with a hot mixture such as asphalt, you can use it for road paving. But as they haul that off, what happens is, and I'm going to use the word hot because that's what lead, that's how you describe it. It becomes hot, and it's the finer particles that are really what's most detrimental to us. As parents and children and pets, you know, track it in and out of their homes, and you have a child that's 9 to 18 months, you know, they spend a lot of time on the floor, they're engaged in a lot of hand-to-mouth activity, and so they're picking that up, and it's lead contaminated. Our yards were abated beginning in 1997, and that means they came in, the EPA, and took out 18 inches of our topsoil and replacing it with clean soil. And what we found out after they spent $110 million here is that our homes were recontaminated in 11 days. Because we didn't take care of the source, which there's an estimated 76 million ton of lead above the ground in the form of chat. And so what happens is they're talking about a cleanup right now besides the abatement of our yards. But the estimation is that it would take a 100-car railroad system working 24/7. It would take 25 years, an estimated 25 years, to move the lead and make this a safe place for us to live and grow and learn. We know that blood leads go up in the summer because children are out more, and if you were here on a day that it hadn't rained previously, you would swear that there were fires all over the town, because if there's any wind whatsoever, it's blowing that residue and it looks like a fire, and it's really not. It's just the finest particles of the lead are blowing around us. And so there are all kinds of other issues that come up. But the most pressing to me, obviously, is the neurocognitive damage that lead does to children when they have a high blood lead.
There's never a wish better than this when you only got 100 years to live.
I was looking for something that would provide the repetitions, okay, because average child takes about 14 to 24 reps. When you were learning to read, it was probably very similar. I remember it as being a happy time right here in this library. I remember it not being a painful process. My children, it is a painful process because our children take 75 to 100 reps to acquire that same skill. And what I like about Literacy First, and what I tell other people when I'm talking about Literacy First, is that staying here every day diminishes the propensity for our children, in my opinion, to pursue the American dream. And I think Literacy First has been the equalizer for our school district. Now see, I'm going to get super emotional. This is where I have great difficulty. Literacy First provides the repetitions that's necessary for a child that has a high blood lead. Linda is more than a consultant. She's a friend and someone that I admire and deeply, deeply respect. She's been wonderful to our staff and to our students, and just the demos and the things that she comes in and just, I mean, I call her on a frequent basis or email her in between visits, and she always has something, you know, that to share with us that will make what we're already doing well better. Before we started the Literacy First process, K through 2, we had 23% of our students reading on grade level. The next year, we went to 48%. The average last year was 76%. I can't imagine where we'd be if, you know, Literacy First hadn't just, and I don't think anything's accidental or coincidental. I think it was total answer to prayer. I think that these children are supposed to succeed, and they are worthy, and they deserve whatever opportunity we can provide them with.